Good morning. It's July 4th, 2021, and we welcome you to Valley Hope Community Church in Hillsboro, Oregon. We're here today to worship and praise the Lord, to hear from His Word, and to sing a couple of prayers to God on behalf of our country, considering it's July 4th. It's a wonderful day to be alive, a wonderful day to be in God's house. Would you join us as we sing? This next song is a prayer to God regarding our country. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grace, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed His grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. O beautiful for pilgrims, pilgrim feet whose stern impassioned stress a thoroughfare for freedom beat across the wilderness. America, America, God bend thine every flaw, confirm thy soul in self-control, thy liberty in law. We're glad to have each one of you here today. There are some things coming up that you can find on our website. There are youth camps and a whole family camp. And we invite you to participate and join in any of those that you're able to. Also, we want to have a sharing cheer day, which is on the website. Which day it is? It's next Sunday. We encourage you to make a phone call, send a note, email, message, whatever, but think of others that you can cheer up and encourage along the way. So we encourage you to do that. Let's continue as we sing together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing. Hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns, He reigns.
As we gather the offering, I will remind you at home that you're able to go on our website or mail it in if you would like to give and tithe. Shall we pray? Lord God, first of all, thank you for this day. We praise you for your greatness and your love and your mercy, your holiness, your forgiveness. We praise you and thank you that you know each one of us personally, even down to how many strands of hair we have on our head. You know us. You know our flaws and our strengths. You know our successes and our failures. And you love us anyway, because you are awesome, and we thank you, and we praise you, and we adore you, because you are holy, and yet you love us. Thank you, God. And now we want to give back to you in praise and in worship and in obedience to our wonderful God. And all God's people said, amen. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
Just to let you know, I do recognize that our country is not perfect. And as long as there's people in it, it's not going to be perfect, right? But we need to pray for help from God, who is much greater than we are. Do any of you have plants at home that are outside plants? What is the hot weather doing to them? You might find that they need some attention. And they need consistent attention. I was watering our outside plants every day in the really hot weather, and then it cooled down several degrees, and one day I didn't water. And I looked the next day, and some of my plants were literally half burned. And I'm wondering about one, if it'll even make it. You know, they need constant attention. And it reminds me of the verses we're going to look at today. They come from John 15, and I am reading from the New Living Translation. Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it may be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. That was the first 8 verses of John chapter 15. So Jesus starts out, I am the true vine. What does that mean? That there are other vines, false vines. And he says, I am the true vine. He doesn't say one of many. He says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. So God still has the authority, right? And the gardener has a master plan. We as people might not see it, we might not understand, but he has a plan, and it is a good plan, not only for the plants, but for the garden as a whole. Now, in verse 2, it says that the gardener cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. Well, every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it can be even more fruitful. We are dog sitting for a few months, and this 60 plus pound dog loves to run around, and there is one particular plant that apparently is in his way. Because one day it's standing up here, and the next day it was flattened down to here. Some of those branches were just bent, some of them were broken off, some of them he took, and I saw him in the yard, he'd stand on one end so he could play tug of war with the other end. Well, those branches didn't fare well, and they are not going to remain in the yard very long, right? Because they are no longer attached to the plant where they're supposed to be attached. They cannot bear flowers. It's not a fruit-bearing plant, although the flowers are pretty fruit that I enjoy. And, you know, as it withers, it doesn't even the leaves don't look pretty anymore, right? But also, it's not just the branches that have been unattached, but the branches who were there that remain that the gardener prunes. And when the weather cools down a little bit, don't want to shock that plant any more than it already has been, I do intend to prune the branches that are remaining so that they can spend their energy getting stronger in the ones that are left. And there is a purpose for all of this, to bear fruit. You know, God doesn't have this garden of people for no purpose. There is a purpose. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. Can you say that with me? The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. Let's try it again. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. That's kind of our sermon in a sentence that I would like you to remember, because it helps us remember our purpose. Verse 3, you are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. I find that very interesting. Jesus' words, when they really live in us, cleanse us. It's not that we hear it and just let it bounce off. Jesus' words cleanse us, and that's part of why we need to be in the word every day. Because his word helps redirect us when we're heading off in the wrong direction. His word gives us the opportunity to recognize when we need to ask forgiveness. His word helps us to grow and mature. Verse 4, remain in me, which other translations say abide in me or live in me. Now, I kept thinking of this pretty cool illustration, but I didn't bring it, so you're going to have to imagine it in your mind, okay? If I have a piece of white bread and I have a piece of cranberry juice, we have white and we have red, correct? Now, let's say the white bread is us, and let's say the red juice is Jesus. Now, the bread is white just because it will show the color difference easily. If they're side by side, they're still separate, correct? But if the bread is in the cranberry juice, what's going to happen? It absorbs the juice. It turns red. It starts to begin looking more like the juice. Correct? And once that has happened, you can't just separate. It just destroys everything. Well, it doesn't destroy Jesus. But anyway, every picture, every analogy has some limitations here. So bear with me. But that is a wonderful picture, I believe, of us and Jesus. When we live in him and he in us, we have him in us, and yet he is in us and around us, and we begin to look more and more like him. We begin to act more and more like him. We begin to think more and more like him, and to even feel sometimes. Now, our feelings are not a good indicator, but of a lot of things. Our feelings can be swayed easily by a lot of things, but he gives us love for other people that we would not otherwise have. Remain in me, live in me, as I also remain and live in you. That's a promise. No branch can bear fruit by itself. Obviously, you cut it off and there's a problem. Or, again, the analogy is limited, but if a branch just got up and walked away, I know it can't. But if the branch separated itself, it can't bear fruit anymore because it must remain in the vine, connected, and that sap that flows back and forth is like the Holy Spirit giving us strength, helping us grow and mature. It must remain in the vine. Now, neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. This is Jesus talking. You can't bear fruit unless you remain in Jesus. Now, what kind of fruit is he talking about? There's the fruit of the Spirit from Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Some of you can say this with me. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And other translations, instead of patience, they put long-suffering. And you know, I think both the meanings, both the words have good value to us. Patience means we don't get upset easily. We don't get upset quickly. It's how we deal with life and people. Long-suffering reminds us that it's not going to be easy. You know, there are people we love that still drive us nuts, right? I'm glad there was no amen from my husband, bless you. We can love people, and yet they can still drive us nuts. And this is a reminder, just a reminder, that we need to stop expecting people to be perfect. We need to stop expecting life to be perfect, because it's not gonna be. That's just the way this world is. It's not until we get to heaven that our lives will be perfect and our health will be perfect and it's going to be a wonderful place. And I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to singing with the heavenly choir up there. That's just an awesome thought. Going on to verse 5, Jesus again repeats, I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Away from me, separated from me, you can do nothing. Now, Jesus is repeating this over and over. Do you think it's important? That's a rhetorical question. Yes, it's very important. When he repeats, it's very important. He wants them to get this. This is in John 15. This is shortly before he's going to die. And it's like, I got to get this through to you guys. I got to get it through to you. Verse 6, if you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. Now, that can be interpreted more than one way. Now, for people who believe that you can start out following the Lord, the seed that starts to grow, but then either the sun scorches it or the weeds crowd it out and it dies, some would believe that a person can start out with the Lord and lose their salvation because they did not continue with him. Others believe that if you start out with the Lord and were sincere, then you cannot lose your salvation. Now, I'm not going to argue either one. The point is to not even get there, to stay connected, stay close to him, stay growing in him. That's the point. We don't need to argue about the other things. Stay connected to Jesus, living in Jesus, and Jesus living in you. And in verse 7, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to glorify my Father, to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. One translation says, to my Father's glory, and the other one says, to glorify my Father, which is the purpose when God intervenes in the natural laws and alters them. It's to glorify the Father. So now, in my opinion, and again, you may not see it this way, but in my opinion, when we are truly living in Jesus and he is living in us, I don't think we're going to be out asking greedily for things. I think that his Spirit is going to change our desires so that things we ask for are going to be of eternal value. Yes, it's okay to ask for the necessities we need. Sure. And, you know, if you want, you can also ask him for blessings that go above the necessities. But remember that the purpose is to glorify God, not to glorify us. Okay? So he has the opportunity to say yes or no. He also knows us very well. And so he might know that I realize that you want that really big, awesome Harley. But in my ultimate wisdom, I know that you would get in a wreck and kill yourself. And I have more for you to do. And so I'm going to say no. See, he knows things that we don't know. And so when he's saying no, there's a good reason. He's not trying to be mean. He's trying to protect us. And he's trying to guide us, focus us in the right direction. For my Father's glory. Are we living for the Father's glory? Are we living for God's glory? That's a really good question that I think it would behoove us to spend some time thinking about. Am I living for God's glory? And if I am, what am I doing that shows that? Because Again in verse 8, this is to glorify my Father, that you bear much fruit and show yourselves to be my disciples. I told a story last week or the week before about a man who was dying, and he did not want to spend their family savings on extending his life, but he wanted that money to go to take care of his family after he was gone. He knew he was going to heaven. He was showing the fruit. He was bearing fruit. And there was a neighbor who was seeing it. He didn't know that. He didn't know that at all. But the neighbor was watching and thought, that's not normal. No, it's not normal to love other people more than we love ourselves. That's the love that Jesus gives us. That's part of the fruit that Jesus gives us. And that doesn't mean we purposely try to hurt ourselves. But in his case, he knew that he was going to die anyway. He knew that he was going to heaven for his heavenly reward. It wasn't going to hurt him one bit to go a little sooner. And it was going to make a big difference for his family, who were going to need those finances to live on. You know, love is an amazing thing. It alters our perspective of our values, our priorities, who we are, who other people are. Love transforms. Now, all of this again is to show the fruit and to glorify God. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. Can you say it with me? The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. Verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full, complete. My command is this: love each other the way I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know what the master is doing. Instead, I have called you friends, because everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me. I chose you and appointed you that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command, to love one another. Do you hear repeating again? Jesus is repeating a lot, because it's so important. Now, he's talking about love and joy and how they are perfected here. Now, does that mean that once we experience his love and his joy, that we're always going to be just elated? No. No. That is a childish understanding. That is not the way this world operates. And yet, he's telling us how we can experience these things. And his love stays in us whether we feel it or not. His love for us is there whether we feel it or not. His joy can give us peace and assurance through dark times. And even in the times that we have despair, he reminds us of his love, his faithfulness, and that his joy will come back. We're just in that cycle, and he will bring us back around. Okay, let's look at it more carefully in verse 9. As the Father has loved me, Jesus, So I have loved you. Think of that. Just as much as God has loved Jesus, his only begotten son, that's how much Jesus loves us. Wow. That's amazing. Now, remain in my love. Live in my love. Live here. Stay here. Our lives go down different paths, you know. We go to work, we come home, we lose a job. You know, we have our faith tested, we get another job, he provides in some way, we lose a loved one, we get a promotion. Our lives go around in different ways. But he says, no matter what's going on, live in my love. Live in my love, knowing you are loved more than you can imagine. Verse 10, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. Just like I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. Oh, wait a minute. If, what do you mean if? I don't like that if word. Don't we want promises that we don't have to do anything to receive? Don't we like to just do whatever we want and we get everything good? Jesus is saying, this is an agreement. The New Testament is the new contract, the new covenant. And he's telling us over and over and over and over, this is the contract. You remain in my love, which means obedience, and I live in you, and it's all about love. You love God, God loves you. You love other people, and through that love, you share the love that God has for them. You love each other, and it affects how you treat each other. This is the new contract, the new covenant. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. Verse 11, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be completely full. Jesus gets joy out of us loving him. Jesus gets joy out of us living in him and him living in us. Jesus gets joy out of us obeying him. We may not always feel joyful. It's like when the father tells the kids, go out and do some chores you need to do. The kids may not be real happy about it, but the father is blessed to see the children obeying. Jesus says he is blessed and he experiences joy when we are obeying him and when we're living in him and he in us. And he wants our joy. See, when we surrender and obey him, that's where we can experience joy and peace. He wants our joy to be complete. Another translation says full. He wants us to experience as much joy as is humanly possible. And it is not possible without him. He wants us to have that blessing. Are you feeling frustrated? Are there things in your life that are annoying you? To me, this is a call back to Jesus. Because that time we spend, and try this. Try looking at him face to face in your imagination. Or try imagining that you and Jesus are walking side by side. And he's talking to you and you're telling him about your day. Or try imagining that you're holding his hand. The picture that I love the most is, I think, a chalk drawing of Jesus. And he's got little children that he's blessing. That's the picture I love. Because it looks real. It doesn't look like he's sitting there being holy. It looks like he's being human. He looks like someone that I can relate to. And I can relate to him being big and great, and I can be one of those children. He loves us. And when we come back to him and just give those frustrating things to him, give him whatever is bothering us or concerning us, and then reaffirm, I trust you, Jesus. I don't get it, but I trust you. I trust you. And it works in us. It really does. That's how we get joy. And Jesus says in 12, again, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Now, how often do you think Jesus may have gotten annoyed with his disciples? Or how often do you think he might have said, oh, here we go again, they're arguing. Just like a parent with children. Now, the Bible doesn't record it very often, but it does say the time that Jesus said, and I imagine him going like this, oh, how long do I have to put up with you guys? And I think it got their attention. I think it got their attention. Because he's saying, you know, you're missing the whole point. You're arguing among yourselves about things that don't have eternal value. Just get your focus off of that and back onto me and what I'm teaching you and what's important. And he loves us so much that he is long-suffering and patient with us. Love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And you are my friends if, he's going to say it again, if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know the master's business. In our culture, we don't like this idea of servants. People don't like the idea of being a servant. However, if you look at a time gone by, for example, the movie Remains of the Day, and back in England, being a butler for an honorable, wealthy family was considered an honor. And it wasn't considered that they're looking down on me. It wasn't considered that I'm not worthy. It was considered that my job is important. I am important because I'm doing what I've been called to do. In Jesus' day, there were servants. Some of them were treated well. Some of them were treated poorly. Jesus, well, maybe not Jesus, but later on in the New Testament, it says, if you're a master, you treat that brother the way you should, that brother or sister the way you should, because that brother or sister, that person who loves the Lord, is part of your heavenly family. So keep your perspective. Keep your perspective. You are not better than them. That would be, in our day, the boss compared to the workers. The person who hails a taxi and the taxi driver. Or if you go to an establishment where there's a doorman who opens the door for you, or the receptionist at the desk, it's not seeing yourself as greater than others. Well, Jesus really was greater and is greater than us. But he says, now I don't call you servants anymore, because now we have this relationship. And in this relationship, I have told you everything I've learned from my Father. I have brought you into my circle. I have brought you in to be close to me, to have relationship with me. You're my friends if you do what I command you. That whole love thing. I no longer call you servants, because a servant doesn't know what his master's business is. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, But I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give. This is my command, love one another. You did not choose me, but I chose you. My understanding of this is that God, the Bible says that it is not God's will that any should perish. It's not God's will that any should go to hell. That's not what he wants. But he gave us free will. He gave us free will. And he is calling to everyone. The call goes out, and we're supposed to be a part of that call. The call going out to others to give them the opportunity, because he is calling people into relationship. And when that person realizes it and accepts it, they choose to accept the call, but God is the one who initiated the call. Does that make sense? And he has a specific plan for each one of us. Now, one person may be up front. Another person may be working with the audio and visual equipment. Another person may be doing other things behind the scenes. Another person is greeting. Another person is taking groceries to the neighbor. Another person is inviting people. Another person is seeing a homeless person and giving a bottle of cold water. We don't all have the same job, because if we did, we wouldn't be very effective. He's appointed us. He has a plan. Don't worry if your position seems to be higher or lower, because that's just not the way it is in God's plan. We are all important. We are all important. And he appointed us to go and bear fruit. Remember, the love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. Faithfulness in there too. But also, I believe this includes bearing fruit as in bringing people to know the Lord. Being fishers of men. Bearing fruit so that your life has eternal consequences. That is the fruit that will last. The spiritual fruits, and when we lead someone to know the Lord, that fruit will last. It's not like money that's going to be gone. You don't see a, we have one in the office where we put the money until it's deposited. Safe. You don't see a hearse pulling a safe behind it, because that person no longer has need of whatever's in that safe. He wants us to work for fruit that lasts. And when we're doing that and we're living so closely, again, he's repeating, ask in my name and the Father will give it to you. As we are so completely in tune with him, what we ask will glorify the Father. And he will say yes. If we're not asking in tune with him, then he has every right to say no. But when we are fully in his business and asking according to his will, he will say yes. This is my command. Once more, he says, love each other. This is my command. Love each other. Love each other. I tell you, right there is enough to keep us busy probably for the rest of our lives. Growing in Jesus and asking him to help us, give us his love so that we love each other the way we're supposed to. This is the New Testament commandment. This is the new covenant. Love each other as I have loved you. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is not only salvation, but bearing fruit. Repeat it with me. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is salvation and bearing fruit. We will continue next week, but for right now, let's end it here. The purpose of staying connected to Jesus is not just our salvation, but the salvation of others, bearing fruit in our lives and bearing fruit in other people's lives, in what we how we share Jesus. Let's pray. Jesus, I'm so thankful that you came to this world. I am so thankful that you lived the way we live. Actually, we have it easier than you did. I'm so thankful that you love us with a love that is beyond our comprehension. And I'm so thankful that you said over and over and over in this passage, remain in me, live in me, and I will live in you. And that this relationship requires obedience, that this relationship includes love, and that our purpose is to love God, to love each other, and out of love, share the good news of salvation for others. You've given us a purpose, you've given us a life, you've given us meaning, and you've given us hope, because no matter what, you are still in control. In Jesus' name we pray, and God's people said, amen.
It's you I live for every day. It's you.